Okay, let's get started. Hello everybody and welcome to the second tutorial of this virtual user meeting. I hope you enjoyed the meeting so far. So I am Mehdi, an application scientist at Zurich Instruments, and together with David Albertini and Adriano Cederos-Gallon from the Institute of Nanotechnology in Lyon, France, we will going to demonstrate how to use one of our software tools, named the Data Acquisition Module, which is a part of our software package LabVIEW, to acquire images, to measure your signal and acquire data and stack them based on your trigger and synchronize them and then make a nice image out of that. So in the next half an hour, first I will show you the DAC module in the graphical user interface where you can measure the signal or demodulate the signal, then you can trigger the acquisition of data and then make image out of that. And then we will move to Lyon, France, where the same measurement is done in a real environment, in a lab with a microscope, but this time using our Python API instead of the graphical user interface to automate the measurement. Then we conclude this tutorial. So without further ado, let's jump to the LabVIEW user interface and start a simple measurement. So in the oscilloscope, I'm just looking at the signal. Let's say this signal that I'm receiving at the input of the locking amplifier, and this is exactly the signal that you see that is usually coming from your AFM. And depending on this trigger signal that you have, again coming from your AFM that represents your end of line measurement, you can synchronize the acquisition. So now this is the signal. As you see, this is modulated, and for each line you have different types of signal, different shape of the waveform depending on the sample that you have. And the modulation is usually the frequency of your cantilever or any side band of that. So let's, if I just increase the frequency, you will see now that this is modulated at higher frequency and you have more oscillations. So that's the signal that we are receiving. And the first thing that you would like to do, of course, is to demodulate that signal and acquire the amplitude and the phase of that signal depending on the type of application or the mode of AFM that you use. So here in the data acquisition module, we first look at the demodulated signal. So if I run the data acquisition, you will see the trigger here, the same as above. And now this is the demodulated signal or the envelope of your signal. And now that you have the trigger, you would like to actually stack these lines on top of each other and measure them. So let's look at how we do that. In the grid section, we have a number of columns and the number of rows that determines how many points you have in each line of the scan and how many scan lines you would like to acquire. So in this case, 1,500 points in each scan and 600 lines. So now let's see what would be the measurement if I activate the two-dimensional and start measuring. So you see that for each trigger, it just stack all the lines on top of each other. And when you receive a signal, you see how the image is being built based on the trigger. And that's how you can acquire image using this data acquisition module in the graphical user interface. Now, the same thing that you do here in the GUI, you can very simply actually transfer it to the API. We have this API log page here that shows what I've done here actually in API command, and you just need to copy and paste this to your API script. In this case, it's Python, but it can be any other APIs that we support. So with that, now we have the motivation to see how it is done in the API, and we can move to Lyon, where David and Adrianus will show us in a real AFM measurement. So David, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Mehdi. My name is David Abertini. I'm a SPAP engineer in Lyon Institute of Nanotechnology. And today, I will do a tutorial on DAC module with multiple dual frequency resonance tracking image acquisition with my microscope IFM. And I do this job with Adrianos here.
And I'm a student at INSA. In telecommunications.
Okay, thanks. So our project is a software development of to do IFM image without number of limit of number and directly from the Zurich instrument. So we need to connect our lock-in to our microscope electronic. Here it's a HF2LI with Bruker nanoscope 5 electronic. The perfect example is, for example, the dual frequency resonance tracking in PFM, because in PFM we need a lot of image. For example, here it's a Z-square program with the magnitude in vertical of on the PZT 2080 from my lab. And here it's the phase of the signal, the phase shifted, and the frequency. So with our program, we don't need the auxiliary input on our microscope, and also we don't need the output auxiliary from the Zurich, because we can draw IFM image directly from the ZD with our program. So now I give the, let Adrianos talking about this program.
So the most important step in programming that script was the synchronization. So it's good to do an image, but if it's not synchronized, well, it has no value. So what I did is I connected the end of line and end of frame triggers that are on the front panel of the Nanoscope 5. And I connected them to the back panel of the HF2LI. So it's the digital input output 0 and 1 that I later program in my scripts to acquire those triggers. So an important thing to bear in mind is that you have to take in account the sampling frequency you need to have to acquire those triggers. So in our case, with the Nanoscope 5, we saw that we need at least a sampling frequency that's greater than 133.3 kilohertz. So, but in practice, we put a little bit more. So now let's talk about Z-square. This is our program, my program, which is disponible on GitHub and is open source. So let's talk about how you program and you talk basically with the HF2LI. So to do that, it's fairly easy because the HF2LI is organized with an address tree. So you'll get to choose what is the ID of your electronic, the D-mode you want, the number of the D-mode, and then the sample. So you can see here some basic requests. So here, for example, you get the sampling rate of D-mode 0. And in the next line here, you set the sampling rate of D-mode 0. So in that case, we put 230 kilohertz to be able to acquire our triggers. Let's get onto the data acquisition module, which is very helpful because all the real-time treatments are done by the Zurich instrument HF2LI internally, so that the programmer, I, I don't have to worry about desyncs, so desynchronization. And I know that when a trigger is acquired, the Zurich will automatically begin to acquire the signal and then give it to me. And now let's talk about the features of Z-square. So first, it saves to gradient format. So gradient is an image treatment, which is it's a software that's known by many scientists working with AFM image, like David. And it also saves in text format to be compatible with more programs, yes. There's no limitation to the number of images you can plot. So for example, the HF2LI, I think has 16 images or 16 outputs or more. So you can do all that, but it's going to be laggy. Also, there's dynamic scaling throughout the imaging process. Normalized color scale, so it's good colors that we choose to have good, nice images. It also saves your parameters in one workspace so that you don't have to retype everything each time. It's auto directory and file naming, so it saves the files with the date, the time, and the name of your sample, so that's quite helpful. And also there are logs to help you debug and to see, for example, if your trigger doesn't get acquired or something like that. And so what's next for Z-square? We will try to make this program more compatible and so that ZKRA will be able to synchronize with other manufacturers' microscopes. And now I will let David talk for the rest of the presentation.
Thank you, Adrianos. So let's do the tutorial of dual frequency resonance tracking on PFM on a strange material, is KNNO, thin film on GSO substrate. It's a good candidate for vertical and lateral DFRT PFM. This sample comes from Germany. First, before I show you the configuration of Z-square, I need to explain Z-square works with LabOne. So I need to show you how to configure LabOne for vertical and lateral PFM configuration. So first, I use demode 1, 2, 3 for the vertical PFM with the oscillator 1 for the carrier and 3 for the sideband. I'm use the demode 4, 5, 6 for the lateral PFM and the oscillator 4 for the carrier and 6 for the sideband. After I put my in my input one on in my lock-in, I put the vertical signal from my vertical photodiode of my microscope. I put in input two the lateral signal from my lateral photodiode of my from my microscope. So I need to put here signal one and signal two. After, I need to find the resonance frequencies here. For the vertical and the lateral. So this is an example for vertical and lateral. I like to take the Q factor of my resonance frequency to compare between two experiments after 1 week, for example. And if you want to know what's happened when you put a tip in contact on the surface, I propose you to read all the Utah-Rabe publication. I'm continuing with the configuration of LabOne. I put in a tab, mode one, the configuration of my vertical. So you can see here input one, you can see here it's a amplitude modulation. I don't forget to change your time constant to be sure to see something on your image. In the mode two is used for the lateral signal. So from my input two, et cetera. And I use the signal output two. The configuration, I'm continuing with the configuration of lab one. After you need to configure the PID, I use the PID one for the vertical with the carrier is the oscillator one. Here it's a dual frequency resonance tracking and you compare the amplitude between the signal two and the demode two and the demode three, etc. Also the PID two is for the lateral. With my oscillator four, I'm compare demode five and six, and I use some parameter for PID like 5,000 kilo, 2 mega, etc. For the output signal, don't forget because you are working on DFRT on vertical and lateral to add your output to. It's your lateral to add this signal to the output one, and the output one is vertical. So this output one go to my microscope, but this signal have the vertical and the lateral information, oscillation. And now let's configure this square, the program Adrianos make. So I have two videos. So I change my screen. I put this in full screen and I start this video. So let's start this square. So this square is started. You have at the left some panel for the configuration of the software. So let's zoom on this panel to know what's happened. So first I configure the vertical, so I put demode three, mag demode three phase. After I'm put another channel, it's demode six, mag demode six phase for the lateral signal. And I put after, for example, I want to show the frequency of my lateral signal. After it's important, I put the setting from up to down because I'm expect, for example, the frame from the top to the bottom. So I put up to down. If it's opposite, I put down from up, just clicking this button. The draw it's at zero because I want this square never stop and make all image in continue.
Yes, it's the number of images. So if you put zero, it's set to scan until you stop it. And if you put a number on it, it will acquire the number of images you set and then it will stop automatically.
Thanks. And after I put the size of my image, here it's 256 pixel by line. You know this value for microscopy. And my frequency is 0.7 Hertz. I want to display the retrace signal. I choose my color and here I put the name of my sample. For example, is KNNO here. I choose my directory. This is a connection. So don't forget to put save to Guidon if you want to save your image. And now I need to connect this square to lab one and my login. So I need to press connect and the color come from orange to blue. Let's do that. Now it's connected to my login. And now I just need to press start to see my my image here. And now I need to wait the TTL. So when the TTL start, the image, all the image start. So let's see. So this image was recorded 4.2 times to be yeah, good for this tutorials. So sorry, here it's a vertical magnitude, here vertical phase, here the lateral magnitude, phase in lateral, and here the frequency. Here, this is the head of my microscope. You can see also the scan of my tip here. at 90 degrees on the surface. And what I want to say is, and I stop the movie, like you see, the surface of my KNNO is very, very flat and with a strange pyramid like this. So you can see, for example, the lateral magnitude is very non-correlated with the topography. So you have, if I remember, it's a 42, the scale between two lines, 42 nanometers, sorry. And you see here is not correlated with the topography. This is an image of one micron by one micron. And here, in same times, we do a movie of our screen of the microscope in same times. So you can see with Z-square image, and also, because I want to prove is doing the same image from inside the lock-in, or if you use the auxiliary output, you do the same image. So here is the lateral magnitude of this KNNO. And when you finish the image, like Adriano said, all these five images are saved in Guidon format directly in one directory. And this is us with our setup. So it's finished for my movie. I close my movie and I continue my tutorial. I hope you can see my presentation. So let's talking about some experiments we do here at in my laboratory. It's Institut des Nanotechnologies de Lyon with our two lock-in from Zurich instrument. So since a long time, we do dual frequency resonance tracking PFM on some materials, PZT, or AGEDO also, BFO, ZNO nanowire, and we work in air or in a ultra high vacuum. Here it's an example of my other microscope. It's an Omicron SPM probe. Also with this lock-in, we do some scanning Joule expansion microscopy. It's an indirect measure of temperature. You apply a voltage to, for example, here to a silver layer, and you can see in contact mode the expansion of these materials. So this is mag and this is phase signal. And also we do some strange experiment in 3 omega with Bruker, with this strange tip. This strange tip is a Bruker Vita tip. It's for thermal, it's a thermal tip for direct or indirect measurement of temperature. And to finish, I want to say there are other groups in France who do some very beautiful image and beautiful experiment with this lock-in. And for example, Denis Mariol doing some KPFM in single pass in CEA, Grenoble, and also Michel Ramonda doing a bimodal experiment and contact resonance experiment, for example, in a wood, it's this image. And that's all for my talk.
Thank you very much, David and Adrianus, for this very nice and detailed demonstration. I'm pretty sure that people in the community would benefit a lot from your ZIS2 software package on top of our Python API. So just to for the sake of time, to briefly conclude this tutorial, I would like to just emphasize on some of the benefits that you get from the DAQ module. So as you saw, it's a flexible and powerful tool to record synchronized data. It can be triggered with the internal and external signals, especially TTL signals for the end of line and end of frame from your AFM. And also you can acquire images out of that. It is available as a graphical user interface and also as an API tool. And the interface, I mean, the transferring from one to other, it's quite straightforward. And it's not course, not limited only on to Python. It's your choice from this list of APIs that we provide. So with that, I would like to thank you for your attention, and let's get back to Roman to continue the